Good morning, everybody. Today is the 26th International Thalassemia Day. It's celebrated today as it's also the International Red Cross Day. Now, what is the theme this year? The theme this year is basically exploring and making novel therapies more affordable. So we'll be talking about what are the therapies which are available with us. So this year's theme is dawning of a new era for thalassemics. And it's a time for a global effort to make novel therapies accessible and affordable to patients. I only thank God now it's beyond. Now people have stopped talking about blood transfusion chelation and have moved towards and bone marrow transplant too. Till date, only two options were told to every patient, saying that TIF is only speaking about them, but today TIF has started speaking about novel therapies. This is a foundation we have been working for a long time, Project Zero Thalassemia. The Red Cross Center now is called MBR Welfare Foundation's IRCS Daycare Pune. We cater to around 80 kids. That's handled by Gaurav Thakkar, who is part of this discussion. He is a counselor there, and we have been holding our session. This is one of the photos from probably 2014 or so. And everybody knows that beta thalassemia major is also called Cooley's anemia or Mediterranean anemia. It's a transfusion dependent thalassemia. Now that refers to the most severe form of thalassemia. Dr. David Weatherall was the first person who spoke about thalassemia major, and he said anyone who gets transfused before the age of 3 years should be called major. But in our course of treatment for the last 10 years, we have realized anyone who is transfused below the age of 1 year should ideally be called thalassemia major. Genetically, if you have two mutations which are beta zero, you should be called thalassemia major. Now, there are two types of thalassemia predominantly. One is transfusion dependent, other is non-transfusion dependent. In India, every thalassemic, as soon as the label is put, gets transfusion, and they ultimately become transfusion dependent. This is the data which all of us know. Sindhis have a prevalence rate which is higher. The Chaudhrys, the Gamit, the coconut tribes from Surat also have much higher rates of thal minor mutation in them. Every year around 10,000 to 30,000 children are born with thalassemia major in this country. So every 20 minutes there's a child who is getting born with thalassemia major. This is the analysis that we are going to publish in next few weeks, which is the commonest mutation that we have in India. The commonest is a mutation called IVS1-5. That's the commonest one. And the Sindhis have a specific mutation called 619 base pair. Now going to the treatment options, there are four treatment options that we all know. One is transfusion. Second is transplant that everybody talks about. And for the last 10 years, we've been talking about pharmaceutical induction of gamma globulin. And now they're talking about gene therapy. I'll try to cover it in a few slides. Now we all know about blood transfusion. What happens with it is iron overload. You need chelation. Chelation itself has its own complications. Iron overload also has its own complications. Now, how much hemoglobin to maintain has been a part of debate. For example, it all started in 1964 when they just took 35 children under the age of 12 years and tried to find out which is the best hemoglobin. So look at these numbers, 35 patients. 1980, they took just hardly 10 in 10 patients, 10 patients over here to find out which is the better hemoglobin, 9 or 12. 97, they took just 32 patients and tried to find the hemoglobin. So moral of the story is all of these studies have been done in 10 to 35 patients. And we follow these because they are all set by Western guidelines. So in India, we need to have our own guidelines because we have thousands and thousands of patients. We need to do studies on thousands and thousands of patients, not on 30 and 40. This is a paper which was published by Sassoon General Hospital about the number of patients they have. This is around 274 patients. You look at the minimum age, that's okay. But the maximum age they were transfusing is 11 and 14 years. Either the patient did not go to them after the 14 years or did not make it. Look at the hemoglobin levels. They're hardly anything. Minimum level of 5.5 and average of 7.3. The moral of the story, all this theory that the people talk about to maintain 8, 9, 10, nobody is able to maintain in this country. And this treatment also needs a cost. All this treatment puts around 1 lakh 25 to 2 lakh rupees of cost on the government itself. So it's government to decide ki how much they are spending on transfusion. And then you have chelation, which is needed because there's iron overload. So you could have growth delay because of iron overload, hypogonadism, all these things, diabetes, osteoporosis, liver fibrosis, cardiac failure. And ultimately, all these things happen, culminates by around 10 to 20, 20 to 30 years of age. So moral of the story is blood transfusion is not a solution. It's a problem for a problem. That's what I feel. We just did a small study of approximately 104 children who had the DEXA done. DEXA is to know what is the bone strength. We found out the bone strength is very, very weak in our thalassemics, more so in poorly chelated ones. And if somebody has very low Z score, there's a higher chance of fractures as such. So in conclusion, majority of our thalassemia major children have a poor bone health. Nobody talks about it. They always talk about iron. They talk about the hemoglobin target. Nobody talks about bone. Nobody talks about endocrine problems. So all these things have to be kept in mind. We need to do DEXA at least once a year. So what is the prognosis with transfusion? They live usually 70 to 30 years of life. And if you are a good, lucky guy who's got good chelation, who can afford Desperal from a young age, then you may probably survive 40 to 45 years. Now, the government says there are only 1 lakh to 2 lakh children with thalassemia major and intermediate, but I feel that the number must be 10 to 15 times higher. So if you add the sickle and the E, the number will go to around 30, 40 lakhs. Now, what is the second option? We have bone marrow transplant. We know about this. We know about the controversy that occurred at a center with haploidentical transplant. CMC Vellore is yet to publish unrelated transplant data of 9 by 10 transplants. There have been various articles being published. The one I want to refer to is this article, which was published in Blood 2016. You can go through it. Long-term outcome of allogeneic transplant. What it showed was that 190 patients were transplanted in 10 years, out of which 34 patients, in fact, died in the first 1 month. And only 24% had a normal life. So moral of the story is if you do 100 transplants, only 24 will have a normal life. Just 34 will probably not live the first month. And 66, out of which only 24 will be okay. The rest will have some of the other problem, will not have a height gain, will develop a cancer, and the iron overload will not come down, the bone, the endocrine, and nothing gets solved, and they become infertile. So what's our data at Ruby Heart Clinic? We have done many transplants. Our complete remission rate in men is around 62.5 with a rejection rate of 16.67. If you add up, the survival is close to 80%. And in females, the success rate is around 50% with a rejection rate of around 80% as such. So total of 79% of patients who live the transplant, but majority of them get a rejection as such. Now, these are the graphs that we use, bone marrow with cord, peripheral blood and cord blood. And you can see over here that survival in the cord plus bone marrow is 100, and that in bone marrow alone is around 89%. So we can use these as a target in people who are young, who have a donor in the family as such. So this is the data from Lucarelli, which is the first paper, which showed around 85% survival, and the Pakistani paper showed 60%. Our survival is better than them, rejection rates are higher. This is the one which people don't talk about. Transplant-related mortality at our center is 20%, 10 to 15%, 5% or later, and rejection rate is around 20%, and GVSD is around 10 to 20%. So what are the negative points for transplant? There's infertility, there's GVSD, graft failure, the secondary cancers, and life-threatening procedure. It's a life-threatening procedure ultimately. Infections, iron overload, you need a donor, and you can do only 200, 300, or 500 transplants a year. These are our patients. We did the first haploidentical in 2012, but I stopped doing it because our data showed rejection rates are very high. This is the girl who gave bone marrow to these two boys who were twins. This is the girl who gave probably the youngest donor in the world at 7 months and 17 days of age, she gave bone marrow to her elder brother. Now, this is our bone marrow transplant unit. This is the UV pass box. That's very, very well needed, at least in the COVID era, so that the UV will disinfect the place. And this is our water purifier. We have a full entertainment inside. There's a laminar road. inside the BMT. It was inaugurated by Professor Ruvenor from Hadassah University, which is the number one university in Israel. And after that, data was published with Ilian Gluckman, who is the person who did the first cord blood transplant in the world around 35 years back. So that's why I am part of the EBMT or European Bone Marrow Transplant Registry, and I'm a patron of the same. So once you know about the bone marrow transplant, we need to know what are the novel therapies. Novel therapies are either you could have a treatment which we are giving, or you could have luspatercept, or a gene therapy. I feel gene therapy is still a dream. What is gene therapy ultimately? You take stem cells from, so autologous stem cells from a patient himself, do a viral infection, and ultimately you basically give a chemotherapy to the patient and return his changed cells back into the body. So you may think it's a very romantic idea, but remember that there is a chemotherapy which is there in gene therapy also. Now, how many cells do we need? For each kilogram, we nearly need 3 crore stem cells, and they have to be infected by the virus, and the gene has to be corrected, and the virus should not do any other thing except correcting the gene, which is very, very difficult. So very important, no cancer should develop, and the gene defect created has to last whole lifetime. It should be stable. And the cost today we know is around 15 crores, maybe 13, 14 crores. What is the result? They are saying 33% patients have some reduction in blood transfusion, probably 40-50% reduction in blood transfusion. For example, if you are taking 12 blood a year, you will be taking 6 blood a year. We are working with CSIR lab, we hope that we will be able to get some treatment in next 2 to 3 years. These are the studies which are available. There are various techniques that have been used. Bluebird Bio is the one which we know. Lentiglobin is a very large molecule. It's a HIV-1 virus, which has been changed and put into the stem cells as such. So what is our treatment? I was looking at my transplant patients who rejected, and ultimately I realized we need to have some solution for the same. Before that whole thing, I used to use hydroxyurea. Now we use thalidomide, resveratrol, valproic acid, and hope we were thinking of a study on azacitidine, D-cetabine. It's still not taken off, and hope we will use it. We still use erythropoietin in the first part of our treatment. Hydroxyurea is more effective in sickle as compared to thalassemia. That's a very, very important point as such, because remember that sickle has more effect in the periphery as compared to the center. Center is the bone marrow. Thalassemia has a problem in the bone marrow. So hydroxyurea doesn't seem to work as much. I'll just tell you in the next few slides. Coming to thalidomide, this is a synthetic glutamic acid residue derivative. Glutamic acid is a normal amino acid in our brain, which in fact keeps us stimulated. And unfortunately, it was used in pregnant women, and in the first 6 weeks of pregnancy, it seemed to cause smaller hands. It's called phocomelia. And if you don't use in a pregnant lady, that should be fine, because still it's used in leprosy, transplant, Crohn's disease, and HHT. It's a disorder in the blood vessel. And it's still used in skin diseases, infections, autoimmune, and hematological disorders. So moral story is not a drug which is to be feared. Now, there are two types of thalidomide. One is R and other is called S. R is sedative, you sleep well, and S is the one which causes all the problem. So if your medicine has a lot of R, you need not worry about having a pregnancy problem. The first paper was Aguilar-Lopez's paper, which used 75 to 100 milligram per kg. And what we did was reduce the dose to 5 to 10 milligram per kg. So our article is published around 3 years back in December of 2017. And that's a landmark paper with 104 patients as such. And we found that uniformly, everybody who responded had a lower ferritin. Remember, in transplant, the ferritin doesn't come down that much as much as it does come in our treatment. Now, we did a second study on the same. And for enrollment of 5 years, we did on a 2,524 patients. And as I said, anyone transfused within 1 year was labeled as major. And anyone transfused after 1 year is intermediate. What is the response rate for major patients? Approximately 82.2%. And for intermediate, above the one year age is 89.6. And remember, the response rate for intermediate is better by around 7.4 to 10%. And the commonest mutation, as I told you, is this mutation, which responds very well. The problem is the spleen starts going up in this mutation. So this combination we use is thalidomide, wheatgrass, hydroxyurea, L-arginine, glutathione, EPO, resveratrol, everything was used. And all this they used because if there is a side effect of thalidomide, that has to be reduced with the other medicines. So majority of the patients do show response after 3 months, and there are very few who respond below the 3 months of treatment. If you keep on transfusing, you will not get any response. So this is the one I talked about. The comparison of response rate of hydroxyurea and thalidomide, we have a cure score which is there in our app also. Where if your score is 1, the response rate is higher. If thalidomide goes up to 90-95%, score 2, the three things are, what is the age of transfusion, what is the spleen size, and what is the Kelfer use or deferiprone use. If you're not used deferiprone, the score is 2. Then your response rate with thalidomide is 85%. And that with 3, I mean, all of them are positive. Age transfusion below 1 year, spleen size is larger, Kelfer the response rate is 75%. And 100% have had reduction of ferritin, and a few people have had reversal of diabetes or reduction in insulin dose. Height increase is seen in 80% of patients in spite of not maintaining 9 hemoglobin. Complications have been... Complications include, in 4 intermediate and 3 major patients, initial part, there was INO, because of INO load, there were complications as such. Gynecomastia, which is reversible, but tamoxifen was observed in around 15 patients, and 3 patients developed cardiac failure due to silent PE or INO load. So moral of the story is, it's INO load which is more dangerous. And we also used sirolimus as an agent because the European medical agency had approved it, and our data does not show a brilliant one. We used it in 37 patients, and 3 of them developed partial response. And these were the patients who had immune problems. They had autoimmune or alloimmune antibodies, and their hemoglobin was dropping because of the antibodies. These are the people who responded to sirolimus as such. Ruxolitinib can be used in people who want to avoid splenectomy. It's a JAK2 inhibitor. It's used in cancer, usually in myeloproliferative disorders. It can be used in thalassemia. I have not used it because it's very expensive. People, in fact, thanks to my recommendation, few people started using Unani and homeopathy, and then we found that there's some response to these drugs. Now, thalassemia, there are other drugs also which have off-label drug use. Off-label means there's no clinical data, there's no case control studies. Like deferiprone. Kelfer has been used for the last 23-30 years without no case control studies. The data is not available between 6 years, under the 6 years and over 14 years. Still, we have been using for many years Kelfer as such. Off-label use of hydroxyurea, of even sickle, was still now, recently 2 years back, it got approval. So close to 30 years, hydroxyurea was used as off-label. So there are many drugs which are off-label, but ultimately off-label is used when the doctor feels there is a response that can help the patient, which is better than the previous treatment. Now, everybody talks about luspatercept. I have got many inquiries about Reblozyl. I recommended it to one of the patients who thought he or she could afford. Now, what does luspatercept do? It increases fetal hemoglobin by suppressing TGF-beta. This is a similar mechanism to thalidomide. What is the advantage? This is an injection, once in 3 weeks, subcutaneously given. So, if you have 20 kg child, you will need around 50 or around... approximately 30 milligram, 20 to 30 milligram of Reblozyl, but the vial is of 75 milligram, which costs around $10,300, which is 8 lakhs. So every 3 weeks you will take this for a year, not year, it has to be continued lifelong. And what is the response rate? 33% of people have, 21% of people have 33% reduction. Yani out of 100 patients, only 21 will respond, they will have 1/3 reduction in the transfusion. Yani aaj aap 12 le rahe ho, to 8 loge. 11% developed hypertension, 4% developed DVT or blood clotting as such. So moral of the story is it affordable for Indian patient? Up to 75 milligram. If you have 60-70 kilos, you could use this dose and you will still end up spending close to 1 crore per year on this treatment, which will give only 33% reduction in 21% of people. Not like our treatment where we give 82% and 89% full reduction of the transfusion. What is the head-to-head cost call calculation? If you do blood transfusion chelation, the approximate cost for 10 years is around this much, survival is this much, and years is this much. Bone marrow transplant, as I told you, the risk in the first month itself is 10 to 50%, and Vellore data showed 34% in the first month, and 24% people live normal, but you end up spending around, on paper 10 lakhs, but off paper you will spend around 20 to 30 lakhs, because you have to stay at the place, you have to afford, you have to travel again and again, you have to travel and time, nobody calculates in this. Travel costs have to be calculated. Time costs have to be calculated. You spend that much time there, you lose your income of your own. So these all calculations have to be added up before we say this therapy is better than that. So the therapy that we are propagating may be around 5 to 6 lakhs in 10 years. Response rate over here has been mentioned lower, but it's around 80 to 90%. And whosoever has responded doesn't develop a complication because of thalassemia, because of iron overload, because of, so they will probably lead a normal or normalish life. I know of doctors, I know of engineers, fashion designers who have become that because their transfusions have stopped. So moral of the story is, what is the risk with the treatment that we are giving? It's less than 1%, and the risk with all others is much, much higher. Now, what is this lecture based on? This is all based on the guidelines. Somebody asked me once, is it mentioned in the guidelines? This is 2040 guidelines, which is there on the TIF website. You can go there. The page number 195 mentions about this in 2014 itself. They were saying the study, they're talking about the two case reports. Now, if you go and read the TIF again, they're talking about the data from India, and the data from India is ours. So remember that today, you may be feeling that this is something others are not recommending. There are people who will start doing it. Pakistanis are doing it. Chinese are doing it. The people will go forward, and then everybody will accept it. Moral of the story is, we can do transplants. We can do transplants for who are younger, lesser iron overloaded with a full match donor. I would not prefer doing haploidentical like people are doing it. Haploidentical has much higher risk. And we can wait for luspatercept to be manufactured in India by a generic company that will help us. And these are the two options. And we should probably aim that a government makes it luspatercept at a lower cost over here. Nobody will be able to afford even 10% of the cost of luspatercept today. Probably it has to be applied, given to us at 1% the cost. Then probably we can all afford it as such. Even 1% is around 1 lakh a year. And in 1 lakh, probably we can get novel therapy to all of them. So that's that for this lecture, this session of the first part of the lecture of the International Thalassemia Day. And I know that hopefully in the next few years, we will have this treatment available to everybody, and probably we'll have better treatments available. I hope that gene therapy comes in India. But remember, gene therapy is also a type of transplant. It is not. It's not just a treatment which is without side effects. The response rate is also 33 to 40%. It's not 100%, 90%. The costs are very, very high. Even if it comes to India, the cost will be around 25 to 30 lakhs per person. So we have to look at which treatment is affordable to us. It can be either transfusion or our treatment of novel therapy. I think these are the two options that we can think of using in the days to come. There are many other drugs which will come and go, but the thing is, none of the studies are done in India. Unfortunately, the luspatercept study should have been done in India because we have the numbers, but nobody comes to India to do any studies. I hope TIF will allow us to help them and allow more of the studies of novel treatment, whether it's related to the family of luspatercept or any other drug or gene therapy also, to come to India. I think we have a strong thalassemia lobby now, and we should all try to get these studies, clinical trials, to India so that our patients get benefited free of cost. Thank you.